Okay. Title is a past and the present. Do you know why I'm not talking about the future? I'm going to explain only the past and the present, not the future. Okay. Probably by end of my lecture, probably you can tell. And this lecture is, in a sense, very special. I really made it for this class, or for the people who are interested in digital governance or AI governance. So you may consider this is a custom-made. Okay. Second, this particular class, you can ask a question at any time. Normally, in a class, first 45 minutes, there's no question. After the 45 minutes, yes, we have a discussion. The reason is if you miss, if you get lost, it will be difficult to move to the next. So if you want, you are not sure, you want to have a clarification, please ask. And I do it in a very introductory level. The reason is I want you to understand. I can go as advanced as you want, but the important thing is a very basic concept I want you to have. Then the rest of this today's workshop, we have two more AI, then an open discussion. It will help. Okay, and I tried this one a couple of times, and people like it, not just for the AI, those novice, people who doesn't know the AI much, including those AI professional. And it worked okay, so I hope it will work this time. And unfortunately, I have a, I guess this is an allergy, I may cough. And sometimes I may not reply immediately, or I may just slow down, just there. And that's something I couldn't control. Okay, this is a sequence of talk I'm going to do. Okay, first, difficult one. If you look at the article, sometimes they say narrow AI. Sometimes you say general AI. So what does it mean by the narrow AI and the general AI? Okay, this one I want you to understand definitely. It's very important. And if you look at the article, in many cases, the person who write the article are confused. Let's put it this way, over 50% of those article are confused. So you have to watch out. Okay. First of all, narrow AI is like a game. The famous one I'm going to explain today is a Go game. Go game, AI software beat the world champion. Okay. Narrow means that you really narrow. You can do only the one specific task, nothing else. That's a narrow AI. The other one is a general AI. It's just like a human being. Okay, some group of those are AI specialists. They try to make some system which can beat a human being in terms of intelligence. Okay, that's the reason why we call the general AI. And so you can say the human level intelligence. Then the things we are interested in is AI can be more intelligent than a human being. People who believe, yeah, it will be, say like in this century, machine intelligence will be better than human intelligence in terms of general. Just raise your hand. Only two, okay, three, okay, people who don't believe. AI cannot be the better than a human being in terms of intelligence. Who just raise your hand? Rest of them.
We'll take them.
Huh?
We'll take them. Maybe next century.
Okay. Or why is it?
Not within this
century. Or why is it? Why do you think that way? Why next century?
Because
so you're saying it'll take us like 200 years, rather than 100 years.
The way it is developing, we believe that within this century it will not be possible to AI will supersede human being. It will take
a
longer time.
Yeah, actually, here what we're talking about, like a Terminator. Okay? Terminator are, in a sense, as smart as a human being, or even smarter. Okay? Then I give just one does a hint. Okay, in a sense, supporting the your argument is that right now we are struggling common sense. Does this AI system have a common sense? Like we have a common sense. And the common sense in the one country is different from the another country. Can AI have a common sense? Look at some of those automatic driving car, the accident by Google. Typically, because they didn't have the machine didn't have the common sense. So for us, it looks so trivial. Even though AI can do such a complicated things, but it doesn't have a common sense. So now when can we develop? But this common sense, we have been working so far about 50 years. When I went to the graduate school, I learned this professor in the University of Texas has been working in the common sense. And it's that difficult. The next one, up. Still, common sense is easier. Next one up is emotion. You think that the robot can love somebody else, some human being? I got upset. I love that person. I really like it. Those emotion is very tough. Yes, we are working on, but it's very tough. Then ultimate is a conscious. Does this robot has a conscious? If you remember the movie 2001, okay, finally the machine kind of start losing a conscious. That's a very famous one. And the conscious is in a sense ultimate. If we say if that person is alive or dead, you check if he has a conscious or not. He lost a conscious, so that he's passed away. Okay, that's the sort of a level of things. How long does it take to accomplish? But today, if you're talking about those AI today, 99% of AI, the one you see in the newspaper, they are working on a narrow AI. People say we have $1 million or $10 million research on AI. 99% working on a narrow AI. The less than 1%, or less than 0.1% working on a general AI. Because you're gonna make money out of those general AI. Okay. I guess everything started in the 1940s, when I was born. If I go by the sequence, first of all, Shannon sort of invented or discovered concept of bit. Bit means a zero or one. Okay, that's without his discovery, we couldn't have a digital computer or digital communication, or we couldn't have anything. It was a remarkable discovery. And it's just like Columbus egg. It's just so, in a sense, it's so obvious. But it was not easy. If you see the telegram, that's we consider it analog, because it's not a deep bit. Short sequence and a long sequence. And blank. So it's not a beat, okay? Then we have a computer. And these are computer, to be precise, by both UK and the USA. Then we have a Memex, was created by the in the USA, and it's, in a sense it's a proposal, because he couldn't realize this machine. It's way too early, because we didn't have a digital computer, so he couldn't do it. And the remarkable thing is the hyperlink concept is the main part of this Memex. And we spent the next 50 years. Many people come up with all those systems. And then in 1990, Tim Berners-Lee finally made it. So it took 50 years. And for us, we have to think in two areas, okay? How can those American, or American plus, say like a European, they can sustain this 50 years effort? Usually, if you work 10 years or 20 years, didn't work, then you give up. But they didn't give up. First, like around 1970s, the prototype was awful. Ted Nelson's. But that's a remarkable effort. And we thought, no, probably we cannot do it. But it's a remarkable, they didn't give it up. Second point is, on this hyperlink development in the last 50 years, there are no Asia involved. So we are sort of catching up. Okay, that's something we should realize. How come we have been doing a just catch up? We had many researchers, but didn't get involved in this development over the last 50 years. Okay, that's what we have to think about. I'll go on this one today and also in Wednesday. And we have to know our position. So then we can say, what can I do? What should I do in the next step? Then the neural network model, it was remarkable. Finally, since we didn't have a machine, so we sort of look at the start of the human being and how does this one works, because we didn't have a digital computer. Then it came up with this simulation of this neuron in that was using some machine. And my personal experience, so they got it, and in the 1960s, I was in a university, then my research lab, we bought one neuron model, costing, say, like, probably $10,000. So yeah, we asked him, how many neurons do we have here? He told me it's about 100 billion. And I think about that, 100 billion, and you have to multiply by the 10,000. That's the amount of money you need in order to have a human level of the neurons. So, oh my God, we have to do something. But now we are catching up now. Okay. And the cybernetics. This is a sort of looking into the, again, it's a pre-computer era. Looking into the human, probably human may be more like a machine. Like the way we control to catch this one. And he tried to sort of imitate using those mathematics. Okay, like a song, my hand goes like this way. And try to grab this one, may not be this one, and such. And so in a sense, AI is the, we try to realize this cybernetics using a computer. And That's one speculation. Like when you say, how does AI really start it? Okay. So that's what happened in the 40s. Then the AI itself, uh, 1950s, we had a Dartmouth AI workshop. Here the word AI was invented or accepted. Artificial intelligence. Then we have those Minsky and all those people attended those meetings. Then always those engineers or scientists, especially scientists, tend to become very optimistic. Yeah, we can do everything. So we had those initial AI boom, like a machine translation and many those AI applications. But the reality is we don't have enough theory and we don't have enough those hardware. We don't have enough those algorithms. So this one didn't last too long. But this happened in almost every those major development in the science. But like IoT, it's the same thing. So then naturally in the 1970s, yes, we had an AI winter, first AI winter. And which is common, almost in every discipline, yes, we do have. First, we have a euphoria, become optimistic. Then we realize the real world and become a very pessimistic. Then we had the second AI boom happened in the 1980s. And we come up with those neural network model and the expert model. You don't really have to know the detail on this one today. The later you may need it. which may be natural. Neural network is from 1970s, 1940s. Expert is a sort of a new group of people. They sort of start from the logic. Okay, so we have those two approaches. Then we have a second AI winter. This was bad. It was awful. Because we didn't expect this second winter. First winter, like almost every area, yes, we do have it. Second one, we didn't expect it. So the way I talked to the people in the 1980s, the people was like the neural network, we can do everything. And the major funding, making a company, all those kind of things. Then how about those unexpectedly, we had a winter, like including a US government, decide not to fund. Then this was really a shock. And up to the point, okay, still some people, very hardcore, like including Jeffrey Linton, they hang on, they didn't give up. Okay, and when they come to the conference, the people, the way they look at those people, are you still doing those stupid things? They didn't really want to come to the conference anymore. Because they treat those people who are still doing, somebody is kind of, they are crazy. But they hang on. And eventually because of those people, we had those deep neural network, and which lead to the deep learning under today's boom. Okay, and then those people, including Jeffrey Hinton and two more people, they got Turing Award for us, computer science is same as the Nobel Prize this year, finally. And I really respect them not to give up. Okay, come to the Asia. Yes, we had many people join this one. Not the first was born. 1980s, yes, many Asian scholars join. Then when this winter comes, as far as I know, almost everybody in Asia gave up. Okay, that's something we have to think about. So in a sense, we are not in a major driver of those technology. Okay. And what does Jeffrey and his group come up, Toronto University and Montreal, and this French, and is a deep neural network. Until then, it was like two or three layers. And this deep, you can make 50, 100, even more layers. And that way, we can solve it. So now we have an AI boom. And this time, still people asking, do we have a next AI winter? OK, conclusion. I can say conclusion. Regarding a narrow AI, there are no more AI winter. We can guarantee you. But if you're talking about the general AI, yes, we may have. You know, as you said, in the next 100 years, we'll have up or down. Probably every say, like, 10 years or 20 years, yes, we'll have up and down. And down, you may call the winter or the whatever. So it could happen. The reason is we sort of, I guess we are not that stupid. We learned. First of all, we need the data. And by now, we have a big data. It's a lot of data, especially in China and the USA. It's a lot. It's like, for example, you can practice with 1 million people, 1 billion people. China and the USA, they can do it. So we have data. And the cloud computing, yes. We have a fairly powerful computer. If we want, we can make even more powerful computer. Then the algorithm, yes, we're coming up with a very good algorithm. Most of people, AI researchers, yes, they are working on this algorithm now. Over a million people around the world. So let me repeat. For general AI, yes, in the next 100 years, we will have an up and down, which you may call the winter. But for narrow AI, probably not. Let's get into the main part. So this is a consulting firm's forecasting. Within about 10 years, because of AI, global GDP will go up more like 15%. If you talk about in terms of the money, $10 to $20 trillion. It's a huge. Now, this one causing those a social issue. What shall we do with those $10, $20 trillion? As of today, the most of those money gain will go to the leading country. When we say leading country in this area, including internet, winner takes all. You have to be either number one or number two to take the money. So the American and the Chinese, they're okay. They can probably together, American and the European, Chinese together, probably they take away about 70% or 80%. The remaining 200 countries, yes, 10-20%. So in Korea, I said, like, let's try to get at least 1%. Was 5%. Okay, this could be a social issue. And naturally it's an AI governance issue. Okay, Kai-Fu Lee, he just wrote a book, and I recommend you to read it. It's a very easy book to read, and you may read it. And he sort of classified the AI industry into the four. First wave internet AI, which is today. So the When you do the AI governance, I strongly recommend you to start from the internet AI. Internet AI is an overlapping of internet and AI. So the, in many areas, you can use an internet governance scheme. Okay, some area you need those additional, those elements, but it could work. And that's why, that's one of the reasons why I do the AI here in APSIG. Because I said, like, yeah, we are doing an internet AI. Then a second wave is a business AI. You may call it a financial AI. This is also very important. It's working mostly in Wall Street and those are financial sector. And the big money goes move back and forth. Like in a matter of a couple of seconds, $1 trillion are gone. It's happening. It's a big thing. But we are not a part of that game. Then a third wave, perception AI, how to recognize. Like how to recognize a face, like China and the USA, they're doing it very well. Those are coming. It's still sort of beginning. Okay, still like a natural language translation, still very lousy. Face recognition is okay, but the video understanding and the language understanding, not quite. Probably takes 10, 20 more years. It's coming. Then eventually autonomous AI, like an autonomous vehicle, the driving, for example, or robotics. They come more in the later in this century. Like when do we peak? Okay, you can read this Kai-Fu Lee's, it's a very easy to read. It's remarkably it's non-technical, even though he has a PhD in computer science. And then he also says like a major AI company today is here. Then we have some more. You can add the, what was it, Mike, what was it? In the USA, you can, like Apple, and China, you can add the Huawei and a couple more. Okay. Next one is, this is the main topic. I show you this curve many times today. And I want you to understand this curve. Originally, this curve was made by the Nick Bostrom. You can read his book on a super intelligence. How does an AI system accomplish the super intelligence? And he believed, he's a philosopher, okay? He believed, yes, AI will have a super intelligence. He doesn't say when, but eventually, okay? And what would happen is, you saw, we are here now, okay? And eventually this one take off. This is a fairly common practice in engineering. Okay, you just sort of struggling, and eventually sort of take off. Then also eventually taper off. That's his argument. But I think this curve is made by the philosopher, okay, not by the engineer. So the don't trust like this curvature and also the discurvature, okay? It's a philosopher's writing, not an engineer's writing. The reason why I'm saying this one is my PhD also, the conclusion was the this curve. So the, I elaborate. And I'm going to show the this curve in term of alpha go and then alpha zero. So the now I'm coming to the I'm applying the super intelligence to the narrow AI in only the very specific area, only in a go game. Still, I guess we could have a super intelligence. Okay. So the first, we had an AlphaGo fan about 2015 hour. By now, it's about 4 or 5 years ago. Then they had an AlphaGo Lee, which beat the eSeddle in Korea, and that shocked the world. Okay. Then they revised to make AlphaGo master. But you don't have to tell, you don't have to really tell, just remember the AlphaGo, okay? And which is, in a sense, accomplished before human beings' capability in a narrow AI area. Then, the message I want to give is, did we expect AlphaGo to be the world master? When you ask those AI specialists, still like some people say, yes, we expect. Other people say, no, we didn't expect. And many of them, we are not sure. So that's, in a sense, the state of AI specialists. I'm not talking about general people. Okay? Even AI specialists, they are not too confident. One of the reasons is because AI winter. They were afraid if eSeddle world champion beat AlphaGo, say like a 4 in a row, then we may have the third AI winter. Okay? Then the conclusion is that AlphaGo won 3 and eSeddle won 1. So in a sense, it's a very good one. It's sort of a passover. Just AlphaGo passed the best human being, the crossing point. So in a sense, it's beautiful, but there's a hesitation. But to me, that one either AlphaGo beat a world champion is, to me, is not trivial. Because like once you take off, okay, it'll go just over. So either we are here or here or here, doesn't matter. It's just a matter of time. So the fundamental, if you talk about the AI technology, it's just a matter of time. Actually, to me, more important one is AlphaGo fan, which be the European Go champion about 6 months before they beat Lee. And this guy was a European Go champion, so like, globally, so like number 200 or number 300. So that beat that one means, we took off already. And once you take off, it's just a matter of time. That's the engineers are pretty good. The globally, so many engineers, they compete each other. Who is going to be the first to beat for such and such? So once it's set, take off, the rest is easy. But still, I'm not answering to the next question. Why just go this one all the way up? Why they taper off? Is it fundamental? Is it fundamental or just accidental? That's very important in terms of super intelligence. Okay, I'll go more on this one later. And Alpha Zero, this is remarkable. You can say this is a state of art. Why? Until the Alpha Zero, do you know what they did? Alpha Go, you develop a software system, then this one compete against the human being. to be precise, the past because of the Go game. And how many times they practice? So a million times. So by doing this a million times, they just learn how others are doing. Okay? So by the learning a million times, you can become a smart. And a human being, we cannot do the million times. Probably at most we can do the one game per day. Then in 1 year you can do the 300. In 10 years you can do the 3,000. But a machine, they can do the one game in a couple of seconds. Okay? So if you have a data, like 1 million those are past record, you are the winner. Right? Alpha zero, they don't need to learn from the past those experience. They learn on its own. Only thing is that you just give a rule of go, which is less than one page. Okay, then they just practice by itself. Then they can say like play million times within a day or two or three. Okay, so once they were alpha zero, this one can beat the alpha go easily. You just cannot compare. So the message is data is very important, but not a necessary condition anymore. Okay, and how does this one lead to is something we don't know. Okay, it's we move into the next phase. But still it doesn't answer the this tapering off. Okay, here I guess I'll give you some sort of a solution. In the case of this AlphaGo, since they learn from the human experience, the past like a million dozer games, so they become more like a human, sort of have a human dozer common sense. So in a sense, you have a limitation of those human. Okay, so you cannot. This is important, okay? So you cannot go too far beyond the human intelligence. Because you are sort of becoming like a human. So what you can do is, okay, I can be 10% better than a human, or two times better than a human. But you cannot do the infinitely better than a human. You can't do it because the data you start is the humans, those are record. Then alpha zero is different. They didn't start from the human experience at all. They only start from the human, goal, those are rule, without any human. So they could go all the way, right? And the message I can give here is, we just, human being, we just cannot tell how intelligent is this alpha zero. Because we understand the something similar to our level. Somebody who is better than 10% or 100%, we can tell. But if it's something which is infinitely better than us, then we just get lost. We just couldn't tell how far they are better than us. Okay, so that's sort of an area we just don't know. But the message is, yes, we have those narrow superintelligence, which is very impressive, and you don't even need a data in some cases. But still you need the good computing and a good algorithm. Next one is this is a very special case. Complex system and narrow AI, this is sort of more my area. when I did a PhD, this is sort of the area. Okay, for example, internet is typically a large scale system. You can tell that how many people, how many nodes, how many data. It's a huge system. We just cannot manage, control. So that we delegate. If something goes wrong, we cannot just pinpoint anymore. So that we use the AI to pinpoint. And if it's a real-time system, you have to correct immediately, then we just cannot do it. We ask AI to make a necessary correction. So in a sense, this AI system is beyond us, our capability. Not because AI is good, because of our limitation. We just cannot handle. Usually the example I give is a nuclear plant. Okay, Fukushima incident. We could prevent it if we are capable. What you have to do is very simple. We had some of those earthquake and the tsunami, and just look at the manual, okay? And find out the how to solve it. Probably you have to do it in, say, like a half an hour. And how many pages is this manual? About 5 to 10 meters. I don't say pages anymore. I mean, under that condition, how many pages can you comprehend? You better leave it to the AI. AI can read either 5 meters or 10 meters, 10,000 pages or 100,000 pages. They can read it just right away. So if we had an AI system, technology of at that time, they could prevent it. So in a sense, we are giving a control to the AI, even though it may not be a complete system. Okay, so when we talk about the super intelligence, not necessarily on a, okay, so back to the nuclear plant, and also the internet, okay, because human being, because of our capacity, or we made some too complex system for the human being to control. So we rely on AI, even though this AI system may not be smart enough. But we just don't have a choice. Like, which would you like? Like Fukushima to happen, because human being cannot read those 10 meters of the manual, or give it to the AI, incomplete AI system to solve. And they have like over 50% chance to solve it. But again, some percent, they can solve. Then the conclusion is fairly obvious. Okay, and this similar thing will happen in autonomous driving. Automatic driving will have this case. Okay, yes, the Google system or the Tesla system, yes, we have some people get killed. You saw it. But if you look at the statistics, how many miles does Google's vehicle drive and the Teslas, and how many people die? You typically count how many, one casualty per how many miles. Then it's so much better by almost all the magnitude than a human being. Okay, then don't you think we should let the autonomous driving to happen? But it's a human psychology. Somehow we feel very uncomfortable, either robot or autonomous driving, to kill a human. Even though we kill many more people on the street. Okay, it's kind of illogical. Do you know how we are solving this problem? Of course, like autonomous system, the quality is getting better and better. But how do we solve it? The my speculation is insurance. Because insurance company, like what's the percentage of having an accident, how much they lose if you ask a human to drive or the autonomous vehicle to drive, and if it's cheaper by autonomous vehicle, then they just let the autonomous vehicle to drive. So the, what could happen is if you, when you apply insurance, are you going to drive or your software, AI software to drive? If it's AI software drive, $100 per year. If you drive, $1,000 per year. So the rich people can afford to drive, but the poor people, you have to give it to the AI. Probably the insurance company would dictate. And so the conclusion is this electric grid, nuclear plant, and the internet system, this does a complex system, maybe a very special case of a super intelligence, which is happening now, as of today. Okay? So this is another area of study. Okay. Almost the conclusion is that if you start from the internal governance and if you attend this APSIG, we have the internal governance, as you know, and I'll give a history of internal governance starting from the 1970, now from the 1990, from the very beginning. And then that one now moving to the incubating the digital governance. So the internal governance contribution is they are the first one we start among the digital technology. Okay, but now the main platform is in digital governance. The hot topic today is security, cybersecurity governance. We have a lot of problem. That many of those internal governance schemes won't work. Multi-stake for that, no chance. Okay, and Sparky is going to give this lecture on cybersecurity governance. Then we gave, in the past, we gave a lecture on governance and the data governance. Then eventually we'll have the major governance, which is the AI governance. It's far bigger than the internet governance in any way. And this week, we are fortunate Woodrow is going to give this lecture, AI governance. Still, this area is still sort of a formation phase, okay? So the today is more like Woodrow is going to give his version of AI governance. And if you search, you can find the other version of AI governance. And if you want to hear the stable version of AI governance, you come to us. Probably 5 years later, if it's not 10 years later, then we have a standard dose of AI governance. Today is we have each version of AI governance. That's how we start. Then, for example, like a principle, always in any governance, we sort of start from the principle. So the internal governance principle, we got WSIS back in Arabian, 2005. Yes, we had one. And with the Netmundial, we revised it. In the case of cybersecurity, we call the cybersecurity norms, and it's kind of stuck. We couldn't develop a consensus. And we are realizing it's far more difficult compared to the internet governance. Then in the case of AI, we are having those AI principle 2 or 3 every year. It's getting very colorful. Like AstroMall is one of the first one. And like last year, we had the OECD and European Union is coming up. Sort of converging, but still takes some more time. It's complex. And we'll discuss more later, okay? And those are the area you have to cover. Compared to the internet governance, it's far more complex. And some of them are still in the research phase, which makes it even worse. And okay, next one. After those are AI governance, what are we going to have? Probably this area, the life science. Actually, some of those are this next revolution, the life science, is overlapping with general AI, especially the brain science. But we don't talk on this one. And the leading AI countries, let's sort of put this way. China and the USA, by now they have a sort of a critical mass. Critical mass means that they have a major AI industry, and they have their version of an AI ecosystem. Okay? And actually, if you're talking about just a technology, okay, UK is better. UK and the USA is sort of leading globally. But the UK's problem is that the UK doesn't have an AI industry. Not the level of China or USA. Probably less than 1/10. Only industry they have is AI, those are finance. So it's not good enough to be those major. And otherwise, those are Northern European is doing well, and Japan is doing okay. And Korea try to catch up. And the future of AI, I'm not claiming, okay? If you want to know the within 10 years, just read those consulting report, because they are making a lot of money, and they can make a good money. So they are working so hard, like McKinsey, PwC, they're all working so hard because it's a moneymaker now. And if you're looking at the up to 50 years, there's a couple of good things. All is somehow MIT is doing very well. Looks at Lex Friedman's artificial general intelligence. This sort of help for you to get an idea of what's going on, what will happen, say, 50 years from now. Okay. And if you even know I live much longer, then if you want to live up to 100 years, there's another course by MIT, by Alex Pine, Minds and the Machine. There they talk about the conscious, emotion, common sense. Okay. And okay, probably I can stop here. And, oh no, you can ask a question. Oh, that's right. One minor thing, the UAE government, actually UAE government is the only country in the world has a ministry of AI. And they organized the global governance of AI last February. This is the first one. And when you go back to your country, recommend to your government very strongly, okay, attend the next meeting of this. Probably UAE will be very happy if it's a government delegate. Okay, as I saw the list, I hardly see any country in Asia.
And the Ministry of Happiness Day.
Huh?
They have a Ministry of Happiness Day, the UAE.
Oh. Okay, and I guess I'll stop here, and if I have a time, I'm going to explain the reference.